Tack till Oskar, Kurdo, Angela och Grete. Vi lovar naturligtvis att använda vårt fria ord för att uppmärksamma de som likt Guminhai sitter fängslade för att ha använt sina. En annan grupp som är mycket utsatta när repressionen ökar är miljöförsvarare. Enbart under 2019 så mördades 43 personer för sitt engagemang mot miljö- och klimatförstörelse. Men digitaliseringen inspirerar miljörörelsen att använda nya verktyg i miljöarbetet. Och det ska vi alldeles strax få höra ett samtal kring. Så jag välkomnar till Globala torget Mikael Durkin från Coalition Clean Baltic.
Good afternoon everyone. I'm really happy to welcome you all to our session today about digital activism. Digital environmental activism in Russia. And I would love to introduce two of our speakers today, Yelena Chernyshova from WWF Russia, and also Dmitry Shevchenko from Citizens Initiative Against Environmental Crime. And they will talk about the use of online and digital tools in environmental activism that is really getting a hot topic nowadays because all of us are kind of locked indoors, and the more we use different tools that support us in our work, the better. And we will learn how those tools have been applied respectively in Russia nowadays. And I will start with Yelena Chernyshova. So Yelena, she is the coordinator of communication projects at WWF Russia, as I already said, and Yelena will talk about especially how the social media, as I understood, is used by WWF in your work in Russia. So the floor is yours, Yelena.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting us here. And I'm very happy to participate in this discussion because you're right, digital tools became super important for environmental activism, considering all the restrictions we have right now. And I have a short presentation, several slides to show. I will ask to start, when I go to the slide. Yeah, so first, what I would like to say that WWF has been working in Russia for 25 years. And at least for 20 years, we have been using digital tools for engaging people in nature conservation, we have dozens and dozens and dozens of examples of digital activities. But today, I would like to share only two of them, but very important examples. One example is on creating an artistic content to spread the word in social media. And the other is an example of our recent attempt to build the infrastructure to support and develop digital environmental activists in a new post-pandemic era. Yeah, so let's start with my first example. We all know that content rules in social media. And a couple of years ago, several artists approached us with the idea to launch the art marathon supporting nature conservation. The task was to create a piece of art, a painting actually, into one of the issues WWF Russia deals with, and then to challenge other artists to produce and share their own paintings. The talk happened at Instagram, which is a great, great place to launch such kind of marathons. And then it rapidly grew to an independent movement with more than 100 artists involved. More than 10 marathons successfully completed, and 3 full-scale artistic festivals arranged by the activists. And you can see on my slide several examples of these works, but there are hundreds of them, and they were beautiful and talented. And we think that the key to success of that initiative was that we didn't ask people to share our content. We didn't push our content, but we asked people to create their own content and to share their artistic interpretation of the environmental issues. And thus we achieved a great result, and thousands of people covered with these metaphors, and a number of new supporters and members joined WWF. So creating a channel content is the most obvious way to participate in nature protection online. Please do it. Please share the content. Please create the content, yeah? But today, digital tools may contribute to nature protection much more than that. And please, next slide. Yeah, thank you very much. A year ago, together with the European Union, we started a project, People for Nature, to engage civil society in Russia in protecting the environment from negative industrial impacts. We created the online platform. You can see a screenshot of this platform where activists can share their experience and get access to the cutting-edge skills and technologies. Could you please show the next slide? Yeah. So the project focuses on distant and free tools for environmental protection, such as monitoring river pollution and illegal loggings with satellite pictures. This means that activists are no longer limited by their location. For example, we have activists who monitor river pollution in Altai region from the city of Nizhny Novgorod, which is 2,500 kilometers away, yeah, and they're doing this right now, right in that moment. And thanks to the satellite pictures, activists can screen some remote areas that were unavailable to monitor earlier in a traditional way, because Russia is a huge country and you not always can reach the point of monitoring, yeah? And the very important thing that they can do all this without leaving their homes by free digital tools, which is extremely important regarding our coronavirus restrictions. Could you please show the next slide? Okay, so it's a short scheme of how this free distance environmental protection works, yeah? The satellite data is free and available for everyone. And this brings us to three very important points. First is that any NGO, any activist can monitor the southern region from any part of the world. It's not restricted by country, from any part of the world. Then, thanks to that, the monitoring results can be verified by other activists. So all data is free and you can check the results. Yeah, you can find proofs to this pollution and violations of environmental laws yourselves. And all this results in the fact that monitoring results are transparent and reliable. They are as transparent as they have never been before. And this is a huge achievement of digital environmental activism. Please, next slide. Yeah, another focus of the project is very important too, and it's about encouraging more people to be engaged in environmental protection. To achieve that, we are creating the digital infrastructure where every person can find her own path to enter the movement. From participating in online courses on some basics of public control over environment, to participating in grants program, to participating in preparing environmental transparency ratings and other activities. And we see that all that activities, all these digital tools for educating and engaging new activists create a kind of transformational circle. Please, next slide. Yeah, a kind of transformational circle when NGOs who are working in their regions, they build their capacity, they improve their knowledge, then they use our tools and our support to communicate their work, to engage new activists, and then these new activists become new NGOs and improve these tools of public control. And the ambition of the project is to make this net not like WWF project. It's an environment for digital activists to protect nature with the actual work every day from their homes in the fields, but using the cutting-edge technologies and protecting our precious nature from industrial pollution. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Yelena. That was encouraging and interesting to hear. How do you use the new tools in the Corona times? I hope that we'll have a couple of questions later on after Dmitry presents his part of work. And Dmitry will be also interpreted from Russian into English. He will speak Russian, so don't be surprised to those of you who are watching us online. And Dmitry, as I already introduced, he is the director of the Citizens Initiative Against Environmental Crime, and he will talk about the online tool that has been developed by the initiative to monitor wildfires in Russia and how citizen science, in a sense, can help in also curbing those fires. So, Dmitry, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Спасибо организаторам за приглашение выступить на этой онлайн-конференции.
Thank you very much. Thank you to the organizers for the possibility to participate in this online conference.
К сожалению, по техническим причинам моя презентация не может быть показана, но я, очевидно, попробую показать прямо со своего монитора, как работает тот наш цифровой продукт, который мы сделали в этом году.
Unfortunately, for some reasons, my presentation can't be presented on screen, but I'll try to describe our digital solution and the tool we have developed from my own monitor here.
Михаил совершенно точно заметил, что цифровой активизм становится все более и более важным. Наша организация, она появилась 2 года назад. Собственно, основной целью нашей организации как раз-таки является создание новых технологий для гражданской активности в сфере защиты окружающей среды.
Михаил was right when he said that digital activism is becoming more and more important. Our organization was created 2 years ago, and we are developing new technical solutions to support environmental activism.
Один из проектов, над которым мы работаем уже второй год, это проект по борьбе с ландшафтными пожарами. Проект нацелен на то, чтобы вовлечь как можно больше людей в борьбу с этим явлением.
A project that we have been implementing for the last 2 years has been aimed at fighting landscape fires, to engage as many people as possible in these activities.
И сделать мы это решили простым способом. Нас в свое время вдохновил проект, который в свое время сделал Алексей Навальный. Проект называется «Росяма» и связан с тем, что обычные граждане, автомобилисты могут с помощью простого приложения, которое у них стоит в смартфоне, сообщать о каких-то дефектах дорожного покрытия. И система автоматически генерирует заявление от их имени в государственный орган.
We have used quite an easy model for our digital tool that has a lot in common with the Rosyama application that Alexei Navalny had launched before, that actually is about citizens reporting different disruptions on the road whenever they see them, uploading pics and information from their smartphones and filing their complaints directly to the authorities.
И нам было в какой-то мере легко идти по этому пути, потому что мы в какой-то момент времени увлеклись геоинформационными технологиями.
It was in a way simple for us. It was an easy way for us to start doing this because for a while we were quite engaged in GIS technologies.
И с одной стороны, мы создали инструмент, который позволяет получать информацию о пожарах на природных территориях, вообще на открытых, на открытой местности, а с другой стороны, реагировать на это явление. Mm-hmm.
So we developed a tool that on the one hand allows to obtain information about wildfires in open territories, and on the other hand makes it possible to react and deal with the problem.
Я просто попробую сейчас со своей камеры показать, как это выглядит, как это выглядит.
Try to use my own screen on my computer to show you a part, one of the slides of my presentation. I don't know if you can see it properly.
Выглядит это примерно вот так. Сейчас у нас к системе подключены 6 регионов юга России.
It looks more or less like this. At the moment, there are 6 areas in the south of Russia that are connected to the system.
Это Краснодарский край, Республика Адыгея, Ростовская область, Ставропольский край, несколько других регионов.
It's Krasnodar area, the Republic of Adygea, Rostov region and some other regions in the south of Russia.
Собственно, что здесь есть? Есть возможность получать, во-первых, информацию о тех пожарах. Вот видите эти точки, это все действующие пожары на сегодняшний момент. И, а с другой стороны, пользователь имеет возможность, будучи на месте, видя этот пожар воочию, может сгенерировать и платить сообщение об этом пожаре. Mm-hmm.
So, how can it be used? On the one hand, you can obtain information about ongoing fires. All the red dots you can see on the screen are fires that are going on right now. And on the other hand, you can, as a user, generate a document, like a complaint, to be sent to the authorities.
Ну вот вы видите один из примеров обращения. Это человек, наш пользователь, наш волонтер снял с дрона пожар. Реальный пожар, который был в этом месте. И, собственно, на карте это отображается в форме точки, которая прикреплена информацией, фотографией.
So here you can see a practical example of what it might look like. One of our volunteers, for example, took a drone picture of an ongoing fire. So you can see it is marked as a point on the map with an attached pic taken by the drone.
Собственно, пользователь имеет возможность сообщить о пожаре с помощью вот этой кнопки. Кнопка так называется «Сообщить о пожаре». Собственно, человек загружает туда фотографию и ту информацию, которую он видел, сообщает об этом. И мы, собственно, уже запускаем генератор обращений. И обращение этого человека, ну, не просто отображается на карте, оно входит в государственные органы. То есть система, робот, сам определяет статус территории, на которой горит пожар, сам определяет, собственно, какие государственные органы отправить обращение, генерирует письма и отправляет от лица человека, который сообщил о пожаре. Mm-hmm.
So what happens here is that the user presses a button, there's a special button, report a fire. If this button is pressed, the system generates a file, like a complaint to the authorities. The system itself determines the status of the area that the user is informing about, is reporting about. The system also determines which authority should be informed about this. And then a complaint is filed to the respective authority on behalf of the user.
Ну, то есть пользователю не надо вникать в какие-то юридические моменты, в какие-то моменты, связанные с земельным законодательством или природоохранным законодательством. Все это за него делает программу.
So there's no need for the user to get to know or read special legislation, fire legislation or other kinds of legislation connected with the fire. The system does it instead for him.
У нас система работает уже, переведена в боевой режим уже с июня этого года, и на сегодняшний день порядка 800 800 писем у нас уже ушло в государственную органу. Mm-hmm.
The system has been up and running since June this year, and about 800 letters of complaint have already, 800 reports to the authorities have been filed so far.
Ну, мы, естественно, у нас есть в планах тиражирование этой системы, подключение к ней других регионов. Поскольку у нас команда маленькая, ресурсы ограничены, мы вынуждены действовать сейчас, исходя из приоритетов. И, во-первых, мы будем подключать к системе самые горящие регионы. Это, в первую очередь, сибирский регион. Мы посмотрим, там, насколько это будет работоспособно. Там лесные пожары в основном. Есть у нас в планах, например, подключение Калининградской области. Это область, которая выходит к Балтийскому морю. Потому что, если мы посмотрим на карту пожаров, Калининградская область у нас всегда выглядит огненным пятном по сравнению с окружающими странами.
We have plans of scaling up this system and extending it to other areas. Of course, our team is quite small and our resources are quite limited, but we have certain priority areas we'll be focusing on. For example, the most suffering areas in Siberia, where wildfires are quite frequent, forest fires in the first place. Also, the Kaliningrad area bordering on the Baltic coast and the Baltic Sea. If you look at a map of Kaliningrad area, at certain times it looks like one single area that is on fire. It is all red because of the fires. Mm.
Но мы не знаем, как государственные органы будут дальше реагировать на нашу инициативу. Пока приходят нормальные ответы к нашим пользователям. Посмотрим, как это будет работать.
We do not know how the state authorities will eventually react to this initiative of ours. So far, our users reporting the fires have been getting proper answers.
В завершении я бы хотел сказать, что подобные сервисы, мы надеемся, не то что даже надеемся, мы уверены, они будут развиваться и дальше в России, потому что это самое перспективное, чем сейчас могут на сегодняшний день заниматься природоохранные организации.
To round this up, I could say that similar online services, online tools will probably be developed in the future, because right now it seems like the most promising area of work for organizations dealing with nature preservation and nature protection.
Спасибо.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dmitry. So it was another example of quite another type of digital or online tools being used within the recent times, and it actually reminded me of our colleagues in Belarus that who have introduced similar tool to monitor nitrates concentration in drinking water wells. So in fact, I believe that the same GIS technologies could be applied for not only monitoring wildfires, but actually other environmental, well, not say crimes, let's say, but deficiencies and problems, perhaps landfills or something like that. But I think I have a general question to both of you. Do you think that we are right now entering into this new normal of digital environmental agenda, and we will use more and more this type of online tools? And perhaps you could also develop a little bit about which tools do you think would be more efficient? Would it be more into social media engagement of people, or would it be more into this type of tools that Dmitry introduced regarding citizen science applications?
Yeah. So, may I start here? I personally think that actually we entered this new era of digital environmental activism earlier than coronavirus appeared in our life. But surely these restrictions, they give us a new opportunity to develop all that. Yeah, it's very difficult situation in all countries. It's a difficult situation for all people, but we must acknowledge that it has contributed to the development of such kind of tools. And half a year ago, many many people were skeptical about this way of protecting nature, and now they understand that it's not only can replace sometimes field work, but it can enrich field work. It can give us a totally new dimension of knowledge about what is actually happening at this very moment in some very important areas for nature conservation. Because you cannot create such kind of a map, Dmitry showed us, when you are only engaged in field work, because all your data will be historical. You can create like a map of what happened during last year, but you cannot see what is going on now. These digital tools, they open a new opportunity for us to react quickly and to bring our attention to those points where we see the most dangerous situation for nature. And when we talk about, for example, industrial pollution, so we know that during the summer there were several cases in Russia with a very, very severe industrial pollution. The first rule maintaining the situation is to react as quickly as possible. And the only way we can do this is using digital tools for monitoring and for sharing the information through social media, because it really works and it drives the attention of authorities to these areas, and it helps us to prevent the situation from becoming worse. So I think that we'll develop both of these kind of tools, sharing information and this kind of scientific approach that Dmitry shared with us. And as for WWF, we see our People for Nature project as a great tool to support this kind of project, as Dmitry described. And we think that many activists should enter this new field, and many IT experts should enter this new field, because it gives us great opportunity to see the true transparency of this environmental work. So we guess that both ways will be developed in the future months.
Thank you very much, Yelena, and sorry, we don't have much time. So, Dmitry, what do you think would be the most efficient? Online monitoring tools or social media, or both? And just to make it...
Я абсолютно согласен с Еленой. Она правильно сказала, что, собственно, оба варианта важны для развития. Более того, скажу, что, собственно, некоммерческие организации, собственно, не единственные, кто сейчас развивает и разные формы онлайн-активизма, этим в том числе занимается и государство.
I totally agree with Elena. Both things are important, and NGOs are not the only players in the area right now. Also, the state authorities are developing these kind of tools.
Но в частности есть некий государственный аналог той системы, которую разработала наша организация. И как всегда, все, что делает государство, это, как правило, неэффективно, это, как правило, очень дорого, очень просто по сравнению с нашими вложениями, это просто космос.
And there is state-owned and state-managed counterpart to our system of reporting. But as it often is, is the case with the state solutions, it's very inefficient and extremely expensive.
Thank you very much, and sorry, I have to round up. We are really limited now in time here, and thanks a lot to both you, Elena, and Dmitry, for sharing your experiences. And I would also like to thank the Swedish Network for Eastern Partnership and Globalatoriet for giving this opportunity for sharing this information with you about digital activism in Russia. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.